Hello everyone. Today we are going to continue with the next part of the human reproduction, that is regarding the title called as a fertilization and implantation. Now first we will see what is fertilization, what exactly occurs during the process of fertilization. In the second part we will see what exactly is implantation. Okay, now already we have studied in the previous classes also regarding the definition of the fertilization. Fertilization occurs after the formation of the gametes at the pubertal phase at sexual maturity. Now we know the general definition of fertilization as a fusion of gametes. Fusion of both male and female gametes together we call them as fertilization, or in other words, fertilization can be also defined as the process of fusion of sperm and ovum. So when the sperm fuses with the ovum, the process is called as a fertilization. Then where fertilization occurs? Fertilization occurs in the female reproductive system. As humans are having internal fertilization, that's why fertilization occurs in the female reproductive system. Then during the process of fertilization, what exactly happens? During copulation, or we call it as a sexual act, the male will release the semen through the male genitalia into the female reproductive tract, which is called as a vagina. So this is the vagina into which the sperms are inseminated or released. Okay, after release of the sperm in the vagina, what happens? The sperms enter through the cervix, a narrow passage where we call it as a cervix. It enters into the uterus. This is the uterus. Then the sperm will travel into the fallopian tube. Now already we know regarding the parts of the fallopian tube. Fallopian tube has been divided into three parts. The first part of the fallopian tube, this is called as the infundibulum, that consists of a finger-like projections. First part is infundibulum. The second part, where we call it as the upper part also, this is called as the ampulla. The last part is called as the isthmus. Okay, so these are the three parts of the oviduct or the fallopian tube. Okay, now during fertilization, this is the ovary that consists of a matured follicle, where we call it as graafian follicle. From the graafian follicle, ovum is released. This process of release of ovum from the graafian follicle is called as a ovulation, which occurs exactly on the 14th day of the menstrual cycle. When the ovum is released, as we know, ovum is not released alone. It is covered by certain membranes. It is covered by zona pellucida, as well as covered by other cells called as corona radiata cells. It is released with the corona radiata cells, outer cells. Now this ovum, when it is released during ovulation, it is picked up by the finger-like projections of the fallopian tube, where we call them as a fimbriae. These finger-like projections, they will be moving and they will collect, they will pick the ovum. This ovum is transported to the upper part of the fallopian tube through the ciliated epithelium, which is present in the fallopian tube. So ciliated epithelial tissue is present in the lining of the fallopian tube. It helps in movement of the ovum to the upper parts of the fallopian tube. Where exactly it moves? Look at this. Ovum moves to the part of the upper part of oviduct. Okay, now sperms has to be released simultaneously, ovum has to be released simultaneously, and they have to reach a point in the oviduct or the fallopian tube. This point or the area or the junction where sperm and egg gets fused, that junction is called as a ampullary isthmic junction. It is called as a ampullary isthmic junction. Remember, this is one of the most important statement. Where does fertilization occurs in the female reproductive system? The process of fertilization occurs at the junction of ampullary and isthmic part. Okay, so that's why. So in between the ampulla as well as the isthmic junction, the process of fertilization or the fusion of male and female gamete occurs. Now this process is called as a fertilization. Now look at the part here. Both the gametes has to be released simultaneously, then only there is a fertilization. This is the reason why all the copulations will not lead to pregnancy, where all the sexual intercourse won't lead to pregnancy, because even though if the sperms are present, if ovum is not at all released, there is no fertilization. Even though ovum is released, if there are no sperms in the fallopian tube, there is no fertilization. That's why if both the gametes are released simultaneously, then only the process of fertilization occurs in the female reproductive system, especially in the oviduct, especially in the ampullary isthmic junction. This is the major point where exactly the process of fertilization occurs in the female reproductive system. So it occurs in the ampullary isthmic junction. Okay. So this is regarding the part of the fertilization. Now, when fertilization occurs, what are the next events that occurs in the female reproductive system? Now, the question comes, when egg, this is the structure of the ovum consisting of corona radiata cells, below that it has zona pellucida, plasma membrane, and this is the ooplasm, this is the nucleus of the ovum. Now, look at this, the sperms will enter into the ovum, the process is called as fertilization. The question comes, how many sperms will enter into the ovum? Because the semen that is released into the female reproductive system will be around 2 to 3 ml that consists of 200 to 300 million sperms. Out of these 300 million sperms, almost around 100 sperms will reach the fallopian tube. Out of that, one will fertilize with the ovum. Remember, only one sperm is required to fertilize the ovum. Then why so large number of gametes, sperms are released into the female reproductive system? Think over it. We'll discuss it in the later parts. Okay, now one sperm will fertilize with the ovum, and the fertilized egg is now called as, so we use a technical term. So what is the fertilized egg called as? Yes, the fertilized egg is known as a zygote. Now here the question comes, egg and sperm, whether both are haploid or diploid? Yes, they are haploid cells. If we compare the size of the egg and the sperm, which one is larger? The size of the egg is larger than the size of the sperm. Sperm measures in terms of micrometer. It is very microscopic. Egg measures around 0.1 to 0.2 millimeter. It can be visible by the naked eye, but sperm is not visible by the naked eye. It has to be observed under the microscope. That's why egg is 30 times larger than that of the sperm. Okay. Now, one sperm, when it enters into the ovum, the process is called as fertilization. When one sperm enters into the ovum, there are certain events that occurs in the ovum which leads to prevention of entry of other sperm. Other sperm will not enter into the ovum when one sperm will enter. It is due to there is a thickening up of the ovum by the release of certain fluids. We call them as cortical fluids. Now, when the egg becomes thick, only one sperm will fertilize. That's why only one sperm enters and fertilizes the ovum, and hence we call it as monospermy. Now this thickening wall of the ovum, it prevents polyspermy. That means it prevents the entry of other sperm into it. Okay, so this is regarding the part of the process of fertilization. Now, after fertilization, male gamete, female gamete, when they fuse, NN, when they fuse, it gets diploid, and that diploid is called as a zygote. Remember, what is a zygote? Zygote is a fertilized egg which is always diploid in number, and it consists of how many chromosomes? 46. 23 chromosomes of the mother, 23 chromosomes of the father. When they get fused, then it forms into a diploid zygote. Now, the next question that arises, the zygote which is formed, it is of single cell, having only one cell. Now, whether it develops into a male baby or whether it develops into a female baby. Okay, how exactly the male and females are formed? Okay, let us have a glance through it, and the detailed account is there in the genetics chapter. So here we'll have an account of whether there is formation of a male or a female baby. Okay, now let us take this as a mother, and here we let us take the father. Mother will produce a haploid number of sex chromosomes. Father will also produce haploid number of sex chromosomes. Okay, now mother has 22 autosomes plus sex chromosomes called as XX. So mother has XX chromosome. Father is having two sex chromosomes. One is X, other one is Y. Now along with that, these are the sex chromosomes. Along with that, autosomes are there. 22 autosomes. And a pair of sex chromosomes, 22 pairs, and this is also one pair. Here also 22 pairs are there, this is one pair. So 22 pairs of autosomes plus one pair of sex chromosome. Okay, so that will be there. Now, during the formation of gamete, what will happen? Now here, both are same homozygous condition, only one X will come in the gamete. That means in the formation of the ovum, only one X will be there. Out of these two, anyone might be there. Both are homozygous only. Homozygous meaning both are having same chromosomes, same genes. Now look at the father here. Father has two sex chromosomes. Now what will happen is when the father produces sperms, 50% of the sperms will carry X chromosome and 50% of the sperms will carry Y chromosome. And hence during the formation of the gametes in the father, 50% of the sperms carry X chromosome, 50% of the sperms carry Y chromosome. Okay, so this is how the gametes are produced in the father. Now, next what happens? During the process of fusion of the gametes, suppose this is the ovum. Ovum has always X chromosome. Mother will produce only one type of ovum that carries a X chromosome. Now, this X chromosome, suppose if it fuses with the sperm that has a X chromosome, that means sperms carrying X chromosome, when it fuses with the ovum, then it forms into XX. Now tell me, what will be the sex of the baby here? Yes, this will be a girl child. Okay, so this will be the female baby, XX. Then suppose if this Y fuses with the X, Y sperm fuses with the X, then it forms into XY. Now what is the sex of the baby here? Yes, it is the male baby. Now, after looking at this part, who is responsible for the sex of the children? These are the parents, mother and the father. These are the children. So, first one is the female baby, second one is the male baby. Now, out of these two parents, who is responsible for the sex of the children? Yes, it is the father who is responsible for formation of a male as well as female child. It is not the mother who is responsible for the sex of the babies, because mother will produce only one type of sex chromosome, that is X. It is the sperm which fuses with this egg to form into male or female baby. Then what is the chance of occurring the first baby as a male or a female? So chance is 50-50, because we cannot predict which will come. The chance is 50-50 only, because 50% of the sperms carry X chromosome, 50% of the sperms carry Y chromosome. The sperm that fuses with the egg, it is responsible for the sex of the fetus as well as sex of the baby. Okay, so this is how the male and the female babies are formed after the process of fertilization and after the process of parturition, where we call it as a delivery. Okay, again, regarding the detailed account of this, we are going to study in the genetics chapter. Okay, so this is regarding the part of the fertilization. So fertilization occurs in the female reproductive system, especially in the amphalerostomic junction. After fertilization, fertilized egg becomes zygote, which is always diploid, and this diploid, it might be a male or a female baby based on these parts. Okay, now the question comes, after fertilization, what are the next events? Okay, now let us see here. This is the ovum, where we call it as unfertilized egg. These are the sperms. When the sperms enter into the ovum, this is the ovum. When it enters, the process is said to be fertilization, where the nucleus of the sperm and the nucleus of the egg will fuse to form into zygote. After zygote, what is the next process? Look at the process. After zygote, the next process is called as a cleavage. The next process after zygote is cleavage. What is cleavage? Cleavage is a mitotic division of a fertilized egg, mitotic division of a zygote. This is called as a cleavage. So cleavage is a mitotic division. That means the cell number goes on increasing. Mitotic division of the fertilized egg or the zygote is said to be cleavage. Then what happens during the process of cleavage? Now initially, let us take this as an egg and this as the sperm. This is N, this is also N. When they fuse, then it forms into diploid zygote. This is called as zygote. Zygote is always diploid. This zygote undergoes the process of cleavage, where it starts to divide its cell. So here it is a one cell stage. A zygote is a one cell stage. Life starts with a single cell stage, which is called as a zygote. This is the most important criteria for the continuity of the life, which already we have studied in the chapter number 1. Okay, reproduction of the organisms. So zygote is responsible for continuity of life. Gametes are not responsible because a fertilization has to occur. Without fertilization, there is no formation of the next generation. Okay, so zygote, it is a single cell. It starts to divide by the process of cleavage. This is the first cleavage. The first cleavage leads to two cells. It leads to two cells. There are various types of cleavage where we also call it as a meridional cleavage. Now, here how many cells? It is two cells are formed. Then, these two cells again it will divide to form into, this is the first cleavage, this is the second cleavage. Second cleavage will lead to how many cells? 1, 2, 3 and 4. So, 4 cells are formed. Then the process continues. These 4 cells, again they will divide to form into the cell number. Remember, the cell number goes on increasing in every division. 2 cell gets converted into 4 cell. This 4 cell, when it divides, then what is the number of cell? It doubles here. Here, the total number of cells, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and backside 1. Total number of cells are here 8 cells. This is the third cleavage. Then the process continues. Now these 8 cells will divide to form into first cleavage, second cleavage, third cleavage. This is the fourth cleavage. So it gives rise to how many cells? It's double. 16 cells. This is the fourth cleavage. And remember, 8 to 16 celled stage, this is named, called as a morula. So, 8 to 16 celled stage. So, 8 to 16 celled stage is called morula. This is called a morula. 8 to 16 celled stage is termed as a morula. Remember, this is one of the most important thing which will be asked for the exams also. Name the cells present in morula, 8 to 16 cells. Or how many cells are present in morula? 8 to 16 cells. So 8 to 16 cell stage is called as a morula. Okay, now this is regarding the part. Then this process, cleavage process, again continues. It continues to form into increasing in the number of the cells. Now each of these we call them as a blastomeres. Each of the new cells which are formed, they are called as a blastomeres. Now here, look at the first division. First division, two cells. These two are also called as a blastomeres. These are called as a blastomeres. Two blastomeres, four blastomeres, eight blastomeres, 16 blastomeres. Okay, then 32 blastomeres. And the process goes on continuing. Then after that, it reaches into around more than 100 plus cells. Around 200 to 300 cells. We call this stage as a blastocyst. We call this as a blastocyst, having a cavity called as a blastocoel. This is called as a blastocoel. Now look at the process of division of the zygote. Zygote divides mitotically and then forms into a cell called as a blastocyst. Now, this process, where exactly it occurs? Now look at the diagram. After fertilization, fertilized egg becomes zygote. Zygote starts to divide. It forms into 2 cell stage, 4 cell stage, 16 cell stage, 8 cell as well as 16 cell stage. This process is called as morula. After 16 cell stage, it gets converted into the next stage. The next stage is called as a blastocyst. The next stage is called as a blastocyst. Blastocyst is also termed as the first embryonic membrane, in the first embryonic membrane. And this blastocyst is the first embryo in the reproductive system of the females, where it contains a cavity, and this cavity is called as a blastocoel. The cavity present in the blastocyst is said to be blastocoel. Now, after fertilization, to form into a cell called as a blastocyst. Let us call this as a blastocyst. From this point, it will reach the uterus. And the time taken for this is around 5 days. After fertilization, formation of a blastocyst takes 5 days. Then after that, this blastocyst, it gets embedded in the wall of the uterus. This blastocyst, it gets embedded in the wall of the uterus. The process of embedding of this blastocyst in the wall of the uterine, inner wall is endometrium. In the endometrial wall, it gets implanted. This process is called as implantation, which is the second title. But how exactly it gets implanted? Okay, so let's see it. How exactly it gets implanted. Now, when the blastocyst is formed, in the blastocyst, we have different cells here. This is a blastocyst. The outer layer cells are also present, and in the inner we have a group of cells called as a inner cell mass. The outer layer cells, these are called as a tropoblast. They are called as a tropoblast cells, and these inner cells, they are called as a inner cell mass. This is inner cell mass. These inner cell mass, they are also called as a robber cells, or they are also called as a robbers cells. Look at this. Outer layer of the blastocyst is called as tropoblast. This is the cavity called as a blastocell. And the inner side, we have the inner cell mass. Remember, these inner cell mass or these cells, they will become the stem cells also, from which a tissue can be grown, from which an organ can be grown. So these inner cell mass, they also form the stem cells. And up to around 8 cells or 8 to 16 cells. Now, all the cells, they are totipotent. Totipotent means one cell can develop into an individual organism. They are totipotent. After that, when they reach around 100 and more cells, around 200 to 300 cells, as in case of the blastocyst, here they are pluripotent. Pluripotent means they can form into any kind of tissues, or it can form into any kind of organs. Okay. Now look at this. In the blastocyst, outer layer cells are called as a tropoblast. Remember, this is most important. And the inner group of cells is called as inner cell mass, or they are also called as a robbers cells. Now, this tropoblast on its outer side, it develops a finger-like projections, or we also call it as a villi-like projections. It develops a villi-like projections. And this villi-like projection, which is developed in the outer wall of the tropoblast, it gets embedded inside the uterus. This gets embedded in the uterus. And this process of attachment of the blastocyst in the wall of the uterus is said to be implantation. So here we come across the definition of implantation. Now, what is implantation? The attachment of blastocyst in the wall of uterus. The attachment of a blastocyst in the wall of the uterus is said to be implantation. This is the definition for implantation. Okay. When it gets implanted, even the outer layer cells, where we call them as endometrial cells, they also cover it, and they also help for the process of implantation. And later on, these finger-like projections or the tropoblast cells, further it develops a placenta and derives nourishment from the mother, and this embryo starts to grow into fetus. That fetus completely develops in the uterus, which is called as a fully developed fetus, which is called as a baby. And that baby takes birth from the womb of the mother. Uterus is also called as womb of the mother. From the womb of the mother, it takes birth, and that process is called as a parturition. Now, the further steps of the implantation. After implantation, how the pregnancy is exactly carried out. So, that is regarding the next part of the topic, and that part will continue in the further classes. Thank you.